Jake Shimobukuro here. Here with Sean Yakubon, checking out this. It's my first time ever holding a rajao, and this was made in the 1850s, I think it was saying. This is really cool. Wow. I'm so honored to be here. All my friends have been here and they've been able to play these instruments, but I always felt left out. So. So the tuning, so this is the My Dog Has Fleas, right? The G, C, E, A. But then there's a low D on the top. That's so wild, man. In the 1850s, you know, you can be a little out of tune and it's okay. so much vibe, man. This is amazing. Such an honor. I feel like I. This. That's cool. Love it. Sorry, I was getting lost in my own world for a little. Yeah, this is neat. Wow.
That instrument is tuned D, G, B, D.
DGBD.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so that's the that's the parent, the father instrument to the uke. And that is around a similar time period, 1870s or so. It's in phenomenal condition, that instrument.
So it was kind of like a low, so it was like a baritone. I mean, it was like a baritone tuning, but the first string down a whole step.
Down a whole step. Mm-hmm.
Wow. So you had like an open G chord. That's cool, man.
Basically these two instruments, and then this one is mine and made here in Hawaii.
Oh,
so that's
no
the
old,
old
one.
That's about 1895.
Wow.
You can turn it.
It's okay to turn the... down to the low ones since they keep going to sleep. It's weird having this low D here. I just don't know what to do with it. Wow, that middle one keeps wanting to slip. Probably better for the instruments to keep it tuned lower anyway. Yeah. Just to hold these instruments are so cool.
Yeah, a lot of, you can see the work and the rope, rope inlay. And
was this a repair, or that's how, like when they built it, he did that, or, you know, this?
It might have been a repair.
Yeah?
Oh, no, that's, that looks like it's.
Feels like it's a.
Oh, no, it is a repair, yeah? Looks like it might have been
over there. That is so cool.
Yeah, and these instruments, in terms of bracing, there's no fan brace or anything.
Mm.
There's no bridge patch either.
You can totally, if you just like tap just when you run your finger along the side of the wood,
mm-hmm.
you can just the resonance, you know, like you can, it has that, the aged wood just has that character. Wow. That's amazing.
So yeah. That instrument was about 2 years after the overthrow.
Really? Mm-hmm. Jeez.
So that instrument exists during that turmoil.
Holy smokes. So these, did you put these strings on, or these were the strings that were on it when you got them?
I put them on.
You put them on?
Yeah. Oh. I need to work with all these other ones that I'll show you. They're strung up with gut strings, which, so the sound that we'll get out of those instruments will be similar to what it would have sounded.
Mm.
But for this instrument, I didn't have gut strings in that size.
Yeah. Let me see. Oh man, that's so
pretty
cool.
Interesting, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's definitely a repair. Yeah. Okay, we'll get to the ones you
I like your acoustic your sound, yeah.
Feel free to just play whatever you want to do.
Oh, thanks, man.
This is a Manuel Nunez, 1895. It's all Koa.
Wow. Just got that old sound. Thank you. Thank you. know, even when you dig in, you know, it kind of, you can tell you're really pushing the instrument, but it has that natural. You can still tell you're, like, the dynamic is there. It's not getting louder, but there's something about the character of the note that makes it feel loud. Like, you feel the dynamic, but I don't feel like technically it's getting, I mean, it's not getting louder, right? But when you put the emphasis on the note. It has to do something with the aging of the wood when it's made a certain way, because I have this Otasan model that was made I think in 1995 that Casey made, and it has the same thing, you know, that I don't even know how to explain it. It's like clarity, it's got the brightness, but the body, and it's just, I don't know, man. You can't get this sound with a new instrument. It's just got to be played and aged, you know. It's just years and years and years of the thing, just, you know, the instrument just doing its thing. I guess the wood, right?
Yeah,
just doing its thing.
I think a big part of it too is these instruments. I mean, if we liken them to people,
yeah.
In a sense, this instrument, I mean, you know, it's 100 plus years old, and the wood, the fibers in the wood are actually deteriorating. It's breaking down. So when the fibers break down in the wood, you actually get, the wood is more free to move in different ways. And that also attributes to how the sound and the vibrations are. Moving through the instrument. Not to mention, there's almost no bracing in these instruments.
Yeah. Hey, so, that's what it is, man.
That's a big part of it too, yeah. But this is the builder that actually taught the Kamakas.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's a beautiful connection.
That is so cool, man. Jeez.
Let me show you. But I really feel like the spirit of the instrument and the builder was that it be played.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Of course.
Don't get me wrong, we're grateful for collectors. Without them, we wouldn't have these instruments. We're grateful for museums because they share that knowledge and that information with people. But I'm kind of in the middle where I feel like these instruments should be played.
Yeah.
So this is a Diaz spruce top, core back and sides. This is 1884.
Wow.
Yeah. So this is just about as early as it can. Thank you.
cool. So this one was 18, what'd you say? 1884.
Yeah, wow. So that's about a little, 11 years younger than that one. So you can see that that has koa back and sides,
mm-hmm.
And it has a spruce top, and it also has a fingerboard, and it also has bridge pins.
Oh.
So these are all consistent with the parent instruments.
Mm-hmm.
And then they went the way of removing the fingerboards, simplifying the bridge to slotted bridges instead of the pins, and then they went with local woods.
I see. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. So awesome.
It's pretty cool.
Amazing that you have all these instruments. That's crazy. Man, that's insane.
There's other ones that we gonna have restored, because there are other, like this is a Diaz, mm-hmm. This is another Diaz. This is a transitional one, so I'll show you. We can't play this one because it needs work, but this shows you the transition. So here's koa, here's the spruce, but this one is no fingerboard.
Oh, I see.
So they basically, there's a slow progression of removing certain aspects, and that one also has no bridge pins.
Mm-hmm. It's the evolution, yeah.
It's the evolution.
So cool.
Yeah.
Wow, look at this koa.
Yeah, it's pretty neat to see those pieces.
Mm-hmm. It's that, yeah, that's how the early kamakas too were made, mm-hmm. with the, was one piece like that, all the way up to the top.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's so cool, man.
This is the other guy, Santo, that we just, so these are pieces that need to be worked on. But he was interested also in the banjo, so there's influences on his instruments, on the headstock, because he was also interested in the banjo. Interesting, yeah.
That's cool. It's kind of like a pineapple shape, yeah?
Yeah.
Almost like a pineapple.
Like a pineapple shape.
Yeah, the top of the pineapple.
This is from 1885, around there.
Oh yeah, very different sound from the other one.
You notice the body size changing too?
Yeah,
it's larger,
getting a little wider.
They're experimenting with the body sizes.
I see. So when you replace them with the gut strings, I mean, these are traditional gut, like it's traditional gut strings, or?
I have to ask Mimo. Mimo sent me these from Aquila, because he knew we were going to be recording a bunch of these, and so Mimo said, hey, try these gut strings out, and I like them, so I left them on, but I'm not, I think it's, he says it's true gut.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cat or? cow? Like, what do they use now? Chicken gut for chicken picking. Is it okay if I just...
Yeah, these
just,
two sides.
Just hold, yeah, two sides. No, I'm gonna let you, man. I don't wanna break it, man. So this is the first ukulele on record.
Yeah, you know, nobody really knows which one is the first one.
Yeah.
The first ukulele, this one almost becomes a name of this instrument,
mm-hmm.
because it was on display at Honolulu Academy of Arts in 1941 as being the first ukulele.
Wow.
Yeah. So it actually looks very similar to the parent instrument, mm-hmm. the machete. It has Brazilian rosewood and a spruce top fingerboard, but it has a cool neck. And so this instrument is a transitional piece.
Yeah.
But it also begs to ask the question, right? When does it become a ukulele?
Yeah, you know? Exactly. Yeah.
Because my friend who collects the parent instruments would argue that this is a machete made in Hawaii, and I would argue that it's the point of transition becoming an ukulele. very interesting.
But it's kind of isn't it similar to, like, in Portugal, right? Depending on where it's made, it's called a different name, right?
So, sort of. Like, the machete
And the
Machete Braga is an area in northern Portugal.
Yeah.
And machete just simply means like minute, a small a stringed instrument.
Oh, so okay.
It's kind of like it's a small guitar, small string, or quarterphone from that area. And Madeira is actually geographically it's closer to Western Africa than it is to mainland Portugal.
I see.
So it's very isolated in terms of, you know, the influences of other luthiers in Europe. There were less influences on Madeira, I think, because geographically they were further away. So that's why you see more traditions with rope. You don't see shell, you don't see other things.
I see. Yeah.
Whereas on the continental Europe, you see that in many guitars and many things, you know, the instruments that they're making there. So there were some traditions that remained in Madeira.
Wow. Yeah. Man, I'm learning so much. Awesome.
This thing sounds fantastic. It feels very different, but that's the first one.
Oh my goodness. So who made this one?
Santo.
Wow. This one has a more similar characteristic to the Nunez one that I played.
This one.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. Tone wise. Believe I'm playing this instrument. This is the first ukulele or the first machete made in Hawaii. Wow, this is amazing. Thank you. those are so cool. Like you said, you know, it just kind of makes you just want to play. Yeah, it's just got something in it, man. Yeah, this one and that other one's my two favorites so far. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, this one to me just stands out, man.
Play more
everything you play, just effortless, you frets. That's cool, man. That's awesome. I love this. Mm. Cool. Love it. I was never able to get a good tone on steel strings. Wow. Beautiful. I love the wide neck. So nice. I wish I could play it.
Should I not take a picture of it?
Oh, no, you can. Yeah, I don't.
Asa is going to love this because that's his favorite. Wait, hold on. Let me get there. That's cool. Yeah.
I'm gonna text him. I'm going to tell him. Oh, man. Yeah, Sean is so nice. He sold me that Kamaka guitar. It sounded amazing. He said you loved it, but oh, man. I can't play guitar.
Let's take a picture again. For some reason, it didn't record it. 1, 2, 3. That's cool. The sustain on that instrument is phenomenal.
Oh man, it just sounds like a million dollar guitar.
Yeah, it just sounds fantastic.